when people don't show up, so I think it would be based on, if I did the math right, there would be like 56 people in Indianapolis that you guys, that didn't show up for their court dates and was forfeited, bond was forfeited. How do you guys go about if someone doesn't show up, then what's the process on that?
So we have our internal processes. We'll continue reaching out to those individuals every 30 days. We'll reach out to the third party contacts that they gave us every 30 days. We'll continue to try to make contact with them. One of the things that we were able to work with the public defender's office on is warrant surrenders. So we'll do warrant surrenders for individuals, for us, and for other individuals in the community that are looking to bring their slate clean.
Okay, do you guys, do you ever get law enforcement involved?
We do not.
Okay, yep. Okay. And then, let's see, friend. This was one on the website under the FAQs. The Bail Project is strongly opposed to pretrial algorithms known as risk assessments and electronic surveillance as alternatives to the current bail system. Can you explain the reasoning, what all you mean by that?
Yep. So the algorithms that are used in pretrial risk assessments, they're pretty much not based off of anybody's future potential. They're based off of what are considered to be past or even relational predictors. And so if my mother or my father have been to jail before, I'm now classified as having a greater risk of being arrested. If somebody in my family or myself has had any issues with drinking or drugs, now I have an even greater, you know, risk of not returning to court. And these aren't predictors that actually really determine somebody's ability to return to court. What determines somebody's ability to return to court is how they're going to be supported post-release. Somebody can still have a substance use problem, but at the end of the day, if you support them through that and you get them connected to the proper services, they still can stabilize and return to court and bring closure to this part of their life in order for them to continue moving forward. But these algorithms are pre-convicting people and making them stay in jail longer than what they should actually be in jail, knowing that a bond is their constitutional right.
How do we make sure, though, without risk assessments, how do you make sure that, you know, at worst, a killing or just anybody being re-traumatized by someone, how do you ensure that won't happen?
Yep. The question swings both ways. Keep somebody in jail for 30, 45 days, 60 days, 9 months, and then let them back out on the streets once they've lost everything. How is that not contributing to the potential of somebody committing one of these, you know, tragic crimes all over again? There is a human being on both sides of this. There's a human being that we're talking about. How do we actually not just lock them in a box so that we can forget about them until we can't keep them there anymore, and then let them figure out how they're going to want to stay out of jail? Or how do we actually support that individual pre-release or pre-trial, helping them get back on their feet? That way, when they bring closure to this part of their life, they actually have something that they can continue moving forward with.
And David, that sounds, I mean, in principle, that sounds like the best case scenario. And do you guys have enough outcomes? And I know you're looking at it, but do you have enough outcomes to prove that that is possible for the vast majority, if not everybody?
I feel good about that. I do. We don't have the number, so I can't say I know to this particular percent or to this particular number. But what I do know is that we're not actually talking about 1,000 people who reoffended. We're not talking about 800 that have reoffended. We're not even talking about 7 or 6. We're talking about a handful of tragic crimes that have occurred. And as bad as that is in its own, it isn't the rule. It's the exception. And if we can continue to focus on what's working for the other 800 people, 900 people, and continue building on that, continue listening to our community service providers and what's working, and continue to fund them in order for them to continue to be more successful, and if we can continue to push those services to people before they actually have any interaction with law enforcement, then we can actually do something about the public safety in the city.
Do you have more, though, than anecdotal evidence that it's not, that it is just a handful and that it's not hundreds of people?
It's not an answer I can provide today for the same reasons that were stated earlier. There's no uniform system in Indiana that allows anybody to look at that data and that information. We are doing that research on our own. That way we can have a better understanding of that so that we can continue, as I stated earlier, learning, growing, adapting, and improving. But today I actually just don't have a number.
Okay.